Welcome to Worship at Christ Church Presbyterian. We're grateful you've decided to join us, and we hope you'll be encouraged as you participate in the service today. Pastor Robbie Hendrick is here to lead us, so let's join him in the sanctuary and offer ourselves in worship.
Good morning. Welcome to Christ Church. Thank you. Unplanned, but grateful for it. So, a lot of people don't live to be my age. And I'm grateful for all of them. Welcome to Christ Church Presbyterian. We're so thankful that you're here. Obviously, there's a lot going on. I want to make you aware of a few of those things. Don't forget that tonight we will close out the Lord's Day with a service that starts at 6 o'clock. We're going to be hopefully getting really, really close to finish up the book of Hebrews. And so come and join us tonight at 6. Our Sunday school target date for us to gather in Sunday school is still August the 9th. I want to keep that in front of you as we continue to navigate our way through all that's going on around the world. I will say once again, if you are our guest today, we're so thankful that you're here, but also be reminded that we are not doing congregational singing right now. That certainly does not mean that at some future date we're going to launch, but right now we're just going to not do social distancing, or we want to keep social distancing, but not do congregational singing at least for a week or two. Don't forget to drop your tithes and offerings in the plate in the back, or you can give online. If you go to our website, there is a button there that can help you do that. There should be a sheet of paper in the pew where you are. If you will record your attendance with us, that would be great. So thankful to be able to keep up with everybody as much as we can. If you're here, you see somebody, and you want to speak to them, just make sure you do that outside after the service. But if you look around and you notice someone's not here, then look them up. Give them a call. Tell them that you miss them. We would love to be able to stay connected as a church. I want to also thank all of those who came yesterday for the church work day and helped out. We had a lot of people that came and helped, and we have a brand new light on a pole out here that's trying to shine some light on some of the dark spots, and our beds look good, and our grass is cut, and so I want to thank all of those that came out and participated in that. Finally, let me say this. Your bulletin, while it is great for the Apostles' Creed and for the outline of the sermon today, that's about all that it's good for. The flow of the service has completely changed from what's in your bulletin, so please don't go by the bulletin when it comes to flow. Again, that's my fault, a lot going on in the church, so that's all on me. The Apostles' Creed is in there for us when we get to that place in the service where we will recite the Apostles' Creed together in unison, and the sermon notes or outline is on the back. All right, let's take a minute, let's begin to calm our hearts, focus on the Lord, and prepare to worship Him alone this morning. It is God alone who calls us to worship him. And so hear the call to worship from 1 Peter 1, verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to the living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. That simple truth alone is reason for us to gather and to worship him. Let's pray. Father, we are so grateful and so thankful to be able to come into this place and to worship you. Father, we're thankful for the Sabbath day, a day where you have called your people together corporately to sing praise to your name, to hear from your word, to pray, Lord, to confess, to profess. And so, Father, we pray even now that you would guard our hearts from distraction, and may we focus upon you and you alone. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's pray together. Father, we are so thankful once again to be able to gather in this place. Lord, we do thank you for the Lord Jesus, who not only leads us, but has also paid the price for our sin. And now sits at your right hand, interceding for us. Lord, we do come before you and acknowledge and confess that all things come from you. Life and breath and happiness and advancement, even simple things like sight and touch and hearing and goodness and truth and all beauty. Lord, we also know that it's not just the physical world, but especially in the spiritual world, that we are also entirely dependent upon you. And so, Father, we pray that you'd give us grace to know more of our need for grace. Show us our sinfulness that we may confess it willingly. We do thank you for any sign of repentance that we have, and we pray that you would give us more of it. Reveal to us our weakness, that we may know that our strength comes only from you. Lord, we know that our sin is offensive and deep, and they rise from a stony and proud and self-righteous heart. And Lord, as we gather as your people, we would pray that you would help us to confess our sin with mourning and regret and even self-loathing, with no pretense to merit or even excuse. Even now, in the stillness of these next few moments, Lord, we pray that you would draw our hearts to you as we confess silently our personal sin to you. Father, we do thank you for the assurance of pardon that we have from your word that tells us that there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Lord, we rest in that promise knowing that you are a God who is truth and does not lie. Lord, we do pray for healing. We pray that you would come and manifest your power and goodness in us. Lord, we pray for faith and an increase in faith. We are like the man who says, I believe, but help me in my unbelief. You have given us faith, and we pray that you would maintain and strengthen and increase it for our richer joy and for your greater glory. Lord, center it upon the work of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, your Son, upon the majesty of you, our Father, and upon the operations of the Holy Spirit, our Comforter. Then and only then can we bring our hearts to you full of love and gratitude and hope and joy. Lord, we need wisdom to follow you. And so we pray that you would be our guide. We need passion to love you more, never wavering in our trust of you. We need compassion for one another. May your love shine through us as we see others in need. We need strength that only you can give to conquer the sin that lies within us. And Lord, it is from this foundation only that we can actually bring our petitions to you. And so, Lord, we pray this day for many things. We pray for the salvation of your people. You have promised us in your word that not one who has been given to the Father by the Son will be snatched from his hand. We thank you for that promise, and we pray that today would be the day of salvation for many who call upon your name for the very first time. Father, we pray your Holy Spirit would rain down on us, continue to draw us closer to you and closer to each other, not just here, but throughout the world as Christians. Lord, we do pray for Augusta and its surrounding areas that you would pour out your spirit here and allow us to be a light on a hill. Lord, we do pray for this country, its leaders, our president, all of those in Washington, all of those who are regional, all of those who are local. Lord, we pray that you would give them a humble reliance upon you alone, and we pray that you would refocus their efforts to be wise servants of the people in which they serve. Father, we do pray that we would continue to be one nation under God. May we have a people who lead us that focuses on the nation as a whole and not just each other. Lord, we pray for our military. We pray that you would keep them safe and fulfill their every need. We thank you for all of those who have been called to serve, to protect this country so that we can gather even today and worship you. We pray for those who have gone before us, our veterans, and the gift of freedom that they have provided to all of us, and the ability that we have even today to worship you freely. We do pray for the world, and we pray that you would bless every church of every tribe and every nation that worships you, the only true and living God. We do pray for those who are hurting, that you would comfort them, those who have been affected by the virus, those who are mourning because they have lost loved ones. Lord, we pray in the midst of this chaos that you would give us wisdom to not be foolish and strength to not walk in fear. Lord, we pray for peace that will overcome the discord of this nation. We pray for those who in your name are witnessing around the world. We pray that you would continue to use them for the furtherment of your kingdom and the expanse of your kingdom and the spread of the gospel message. Lord, we have so much to be thankful for. But most of all, we thank you for Jesus, the one who leads us and the one who taught us how to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. It is obviously not only good for us to confess our sins, but also to profess what we believe. We do that here through the recitation of the Apostles' Creed, which is found in your bulletin. I will ask you, Christian, what is it that you believe?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you.
Take your Bibles, if you would, and turn to John chapter 8. John chapter 8. If you did not bring your Bible, there should be one there in the pew in front of you. If you do not own a Bible, then may I suggest that you take that one as our gift to you. We do replenish those from time to time and want everybody to have a copy of the Scriptures. John chapter 8, today we're going to be looking at verses 12 through 30. We took a break last week to focus on God's hand upon this country as we celebrate not only our independence, but also celebrating our dependence on Him as we worship and sing praise to Him for His perfections of His character and His law, His power to establish this land, and His providence over this land. So today we get back to the Gospel of John. Now, normally whenever we take a break from a book like this, we kind of have to go back and do a little bit of recap. So let me set us up for where we are today. The last time we looked at just one verse, which was John 8:12. Here's what it says. Jesus spoke to them saying, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." Now, Jesus spoke this during what is called the Feast of Booths, a time when the Jews built booths or tents and lived in them for 8 days to remember God's goodness to His people back in the desert. The story is told to us in Exodus, when God faithfully gave them manna from heaven and water from the rock and a pillar of cloud by day and fire by night, constantly showing His presence to the nation of Israel. This feast was prescribed by God in the book of Leviticus. And one of the ceremonies during the week was placing these big lights in the temple. It was actually the court of the women of the temple, and to remind the people of the cloud by day and the fire by night. And it was in the context of placing these big, huge lights representing God's pillar that Jesus says, "I am the light of the world." So we're going to read 8:12 again, but we're going to go through verse 30. That's our setup. John chapter 8, starting with verse 12, hear the inerrant and infallible word of God. Again, Jesus spoke to them saying, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." So the Pharisees said to him, "You are bearing witness about yourself. Your testimony is not true." Jesus answered, "Even if I do bear witness about myself, my testimony is true. For I know where I came from and where I am going, but you do not know where I come from or where I am going. You judge according to the flesh. I judge no one. Yet even if I do judge, my judgment is true, for it is not I alone who judge, but I and the Father who sent me. In your law, it is written that the testimony of two people is true. I am the one who bears witness about myself, and the Father who sent me bears witness about me." They said to him, "Therefore, where is your Father?" Jesus answered, "You know neither me nor my Father. If you knew me, you would know my Father also." These words he spoke in the treasury as he taught in the temple, but no one arrested him because his hour had not yet come. So he said to them again, "I'm going away, and you will seek me, and you will die in your sin. Where I am going, you cannot come." So the Jews said, "Will he kill himself, since he says, 'Where I am going, you cannot come'?" He said to them, "You are from below, I am from above. You are of this world, I am not of this world. I told you that you would die in your sins, for unless you believe that I am he, you will die in your sins." So they said to him, "Who are you?" Jesus said to them, "Just what I have been telling you from the beginning. I have much to say about you and much to judge, but he who sent me is true, and I declare to the world that I have heard from him." They did not understand that he had been speaking to them about the Father. So Jesus said to them, "When you have lifted up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am he, and that I do nothing on my own authority, but speak just as the Father taught me. And he who sent me is with me. He has not left me alone, for I always do the things that are pleasing to him." As he was saying these things, many believed in him. This ends the reading of God's word. Let's pray. Father, we are so grateful to be able to hear from you this morning. And we pray, Lord, that you would open our eyes to see and our ears to hear and our minds to comprehend what you have for us this day. God, we pray that you would change our hearts to be more like you. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So I think that we are very familiar with the term witness or testimony. It keeps popping up in the book of John more than we really think about unless we go back and study it as one word. Mainly, this idea of witness or testimony pops up because many people don't believe who Jesus claims to be, the Messiah who came from heaven to pay for sin. So now the Pharisees are beginning to challenge Jesus, and they challenge his self-proclamation. Now, up to now, we have seen a lot of people profess Jesus as Lord, people giving their testimony about him. There's been a lot in the book of John up to now. In fact, this is Roman numeral number one. I call it other witnesses. The Apostle John, who wrote the book, here's what he said right out of the gate. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And immediately following that, the Apostle John introduces John the Baptist. Chapter 1, verse 6, there was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness, to bear witness about the light, and there's the term again, that all might believe through him. John, the Baptist, actually calls Jesus the Son of God in chapter 1, and then he says, look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. We've seen other testimonies like Andrew, who said, we have found the Messiah, or Philip, who said, we have found the one that Moses wrote about in the Old Testament, or Nathanael, who says, you are the Son of God, the King of Israel. We've had a lot of people up to now profess who Jesus is. And on top of all of these witnesses, now Jesus gives a witness about himself, which is really Roman numeral 2. And the first thing that he does is he confirms what all of these other people are saying. Jesus himself says, listen, there are other witnesses other than myself, and everything that they say about me is true. John the Baptist, Jesus back in chapter 5 says, John has borne witness to the truth. In other words, what John said about me, he's right. And Jesus says, listen, the works of God testify about me. Chapter 5, verse 36, the very works that I'm doing bear witness about me that the Father has sent me. Jesus said, the Father himself testifies about me. Chapter 5, verse 37, the Father who sent me has himself borne witness about me. Now, we know this from Jesus' baptism, and we read a little bit about it in John, where Jesus is baptized, and God says, this is my Son with whom I am well pleased. And in Acts chapter 2, 22, it says that God attested to you about Jesus because of the miracles that God did through Christ. And finally, Jesus says, listen, the scriptures testify about me. In chapter 5, verse 39, you search the scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life, and it is they that bear witness about me. Jesus says, listen, all of these things up to now that are attesting about who I am, believe them all. Jesus says, listen, there are other people who testify to who I am, and yet I'm still going to stand here and tell you who I am too. And he confesses his own identity up to now, four times. Number one, he proclaimed to be the Messiah. Chapter 4, verses 25 and 26, the woman at the well, she looks at him and she says, I know that Messiah is coming, he who is called the Christ, and when he comes, he will tell us these things. And Jesus looks at her and says, I who speak to you am he. He has proclaimed up to this point to be the bread of life. Chapter 6, 35, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall not thirst. Number three, he is proclaimed to be the living water. We talked about this 2 weeks ago on the last day of the feast when the priests were carrying the water up from the river to the temple, praising God for providing water from the rock back in Exodus. Jesus stands up in chapter 7, verse 27, and cried out, "If anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water." And now here he proclaims to be the light of the world. "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." Jesus is making some incredible claims about himself. Incredible claims to being the Messiah, the Son of God and Savior of sinners, the one that they had been waiting for, the one that they had been studying, the one that they had been praying for, the one that was from heaven, though they knew his parents, the one who claimed to speak with authority of God, yet to them had broken the law of God on the Sabbath when he healed somebody. The one who claimed equality with God, and yet they claimed he was blaspheming. The one who told the religious leaders of the day they could not go where he was going, which is heaven, because they did not believe in him, and then proclaimed to them that they would die in their sin. Verse 24, "Unless you believe that I am he." Now, all of this, Jesus' self-proclamation with all of these people also proclaiming who he is, has now created this huge division with the Pharisees. The religious leaders being told that their understanding of faith is all wrong, that the guy that they're looking for is standing before them, and yet they don't believe it. Jesus is now a threat to them. A threat to their way of life, a threat to their faith, a threat to their belief. And so how do they refute him? How do they stop him? How do they get rid of his testimony? What are they to do? There are only three possibilities when it comes to Jesus testifying about himself. How do we remove that testimony? That's Roman numeral number three. One is to eliminate the witness. Now listen, this is true of any witness even today, but we see this with Jesus pretty clearly. The Pharisees had already tried to eliminate Jesus, proclaiming that he was preaching and teaching heresy. If we go back to chapter 5, here's what we read in verse 18. This was why the Jews were seeking all the more to kill Jesus. Because not only was he breaking the Sabbath, but he was even calling to his own Father, making himself equal with God. Chapter 7, verse 1, Jesus would not go about in Judea because the Jews were seeking to kill him. They were trying to eliminate the witness. They even tried to kill him with the reasoning that he had a demon inside of him. This is chapter 7, verse 26. They tried to arrest him several times, chapter 7, verse 30 and 32, and the Bible says no one laid a hand on him because his time had not yet come. And so if you can't eliminate the witness, the second thing you can do is to discredit the witness. And there are three ways that you can discredit the witness. And one is to ask for proof of what you proclaim. You say you're the Messiah that we've been waiting for, then show us some signs. How many times have we seen, how many times have they asked for a sign from Jesus to prove who he says he is, and yet at least in their eyes, he has not given them one single sign? Now, we know that's not true. We've read about a lot of signs. Their mindset was, we've asked for a sign, he's given us nothing. Chapter 2, verse 18, "What sign do you show us for doing these things?" Chapter 6, verse 30, "What sign do you do that we may see and believe you?" In order to discredit a witness, you either ask for proof, you ask for a sign, And they didn't get it. So the second thing you do to discredit them is try to entrap him. Create a scenario where, regardless of how a question is answered, Jesus has now been backed into a corner and he's going to be wrong. This is exactly what happened with the woman caught in adultery in John chapter 8. John chapter 8, verses 5 and 6. Now in the law, Moses commanded us to stone such women. So what do you say? This they said to test him, that they might have some charge to bring against him. Here's their thinking. If we find a charge, we can then arrest him and discredit his testimony about himself. We see this also in Matthew chapter 19 regarding the issue of divorce. Chapter 19, verse 3, the Pharisees came up to Jesus and tested him. That's always a sign for us. Tested him by asking, is it lawful to divorce one's wife for any cause? Now, why would they ask that question? Trying to trick him to giving the wrong answer, because it's a catch-22, depending on how you answer it. Now, Jesus answers this question, and then they ask a follow-up question. If what you're saying is true, then why did Moses command one to give a certificate of divorce and to send her away? And Jesus answers that too and offends them deeply. He simply says, because of the hardness of man's heart. Now, if proof doesn't work, or entrapment doesn't work, there is a third way to discredit the witness. And that is to make him out to be a liar. What about these claims? He claims that he is from heaven. But we know his parents. In fact, we've known Mary and Joseph for years. Chapter 6, verse 42 and 7:27. Jesus claims to forgive sin, but yet he can't prove it. I mean, how do you prove that somebody's sin is forgiven? Jesus claims to grant eternal life. Well, only God can do that. So he's a liar. Jesus claims that his works are God's works, that his miracles are God's miracles. He claims to be the bread, the living water, the light. According to the Jewish leaders, Jesus was blaspheming against God. This is crazy. We know that only God can attest to those things. Therefore, Jesus is a liar and not a credible witness at all. They could not eliminate him. And at the end of the day, they could not discredit him. And so, see, they try to throw out his testimony on a technicality. And this is what's going on in verse 13. Look with me at verse 13. You are bearing witness about yourself. Your testimony is not true. The word there is valid. So where is this coming from? In order to understand it, guess what? We got to go back to the Old Testament. We do this a lot. The Old Testament is connected to the New. We go back to the Mosaic Law. In Numbers 35:30, the Bible says, no one is to be put to death on the testimony of only one witness. Deuteronomy 17:6. Now, let me pause for a brief commercial. Deuteronomy means second law. Deutero means second. Namas means law. So this is the second time that Moses has gathered the people to give them the law of God before they go into the promised land. And so here's what he says in Deuteronomy 17:6. On the testimony of two or three witnesses, a man shall be put to death, but no one shall be put to death on the testimony of only one witness. What are the Pharisees saying? Jesus, you're the only witness. Your testimony is not valid. Deuteronomy 19:15 says, at the mouth of two witnesses or at the mouth of three witnesses shall the matter be established. According to the broad interpretation of the Mosaic Law, two witnesses needed to testify in order for anything to be claimed true. Now, because of the heart of men, two witnesses do not declare guilt. But it does offer an opportunity for a trial. In 1 Kings 21, Jezebel fakes a letter from her husband to get rid of Naboth. And in the letter, she says, set up two worthless men opposite him and let them bring a fake charge against him. So we know the heart of man is bad. And we know that two witnesses can lie. In fact, when we get to the end of Jesus' life, they have set up two false witnesses against Jesus. So two witnesses doesn't guarantee guilt, but it does establish the opportunity for a trial. The Pharisees look at Jesus and they say, your testimony is not valid because you are the only one who's giving it. In fact, Jesus actually said the same thing earlier in John chapter 5. He says, if I alone bear witness about myself, my testimony is not deemed true. He actually confirms what the Pharisees are saying to him. The problem with the Jewish leaders is that Jesus was not alone in his declaration. What about John the Baptist? What about John the Apostle? What about Andrew or Philip or Nathaniel or Peter or Matthew or any of the other people that were walking with him at that particular time? And what about all of those that we've read about that said, and some believed? That's even in this passage. And some believed. What about those people? They too can be witnesses. At least three or four times we have read, many believed. Jesus has hundreds of witnesses, not to mention, which we've already mentioned, his works and the scriptures. But what is so amazing is that Jesus doesn't use any of those people to prove his testimony is true. He doesn't use any of those people. He doesn't use any of the miracles, any of the signs. What he does is rebukes the Pharisees. Look at verse 14. Even if I do bear witness about myself, my testimony is true, for I know where I came from and where I am going, but you do not know where I came from or where I'm going. Listen, he defends his own testimony and he discredits theirs because they were ignorant of the two basic questions involved in Jesus' life and ministry. The question of his origin, where did you come from? And the question of his destiny, where are you going? And on top of that, he says, you don't know me or my Father. And they prove this when they turn around in verse 25 and say, who are you? Jesus exposes their ignorance. They don't know who he is. They don't know where he came from. They don't know where he's going. They don't know his Father. And at the heart of all of it, they don't know him. Verse 19, if you knew me, and because of that, they cannot go where he is going. And they will die in their sin. And Jesus looks at them and says, it is your testimony that is not valid. Now, if you want to know what makes my testimony valid, Jesus says, he doesn't go back and list those people. He says, I have two witnesses, me and the Father. Look at verse 17. I'm at Roman numeral number 4, by the way. In your law, it is written that the testimony of two men is true. Jesus says, listen, I have to. Look at verse 18. I am the one who bears witness about myself, and the Father who sent me bears witness about me. The witness of God the Father is given to us how? How do we have it? We know from his spoken word, this is my Son with whom I'm well pleased, but we also have his witness through his written word. Chapter 5, verse 39, you search the scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life. And yet it is the scriptures that bear witness about me. Jesus is saying God's witness about me is found in his word. Neither of these witnesses, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, and God the Father, can be eliminated or discredited. Hallelujah. And both can give proof of their testimony through creation, through the word, through the life and death and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what gives credibility to his testimony, because they cannot be eliminated or discredited. And they can be proved. All right, a couple of takeaways. Y'all still hanging with me? A face mask head nod would be good. All right. In verse 25, they ask him, "Who are you?" And it's funny that they would not take his personal testimony, but then they ask him for it. And the answer is simple. Verse 25 says, just what I have been telling you from the beginning. You want to know who I am? I've already told you. That's the blessing of the Lord Jesus Christ in our lives every single day. If we want to know who Jesus is, he tells us. If we search for Christ, he reveals himself. What's he said so far? I am the Messiah. I am the bread of life. I am the living water. I am the light of the world. When we come and say, Jesus, who are you? He says, here's who I am. And he reveals himself to us. It's this beautiful picture of the gospel message in a nutshell right there. That's number one. Number two, who gets to bear witness to Jesus? Well, obviously Christians do. It's very important for us to know that. We are all witnesses to Jesus Christ. We are called to proclaim the truth. Acts chapter 1, verse 8 tells us, you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all of Judea and Samaria, even to the end of the earth. Now, what is the problem with us being the only witness to Jesus Christ? We are sinners and we're fallible, which means that we can be very easily eliminated or discredited because we are broken, sinful, liars. And so the non-Christian world looks at us and says, how do I know that your testimony is credible when I see your life? But here's my challenge, and I think the scriptures mandate to us. Even if we can be discredited, it does not mean we become silent. And so even though we can be discredited or even eliminated, i.e. fed to the lions, we are still called to be a witness even unto death. Now, the great news is that we are not the only witnesses. Who else is to be a witness? God himself bears witness through his word. Luke 24, 27, Jesus, the two guys on the road to Emmaus, here's what happens. You already know the story. Verse 27, beginning with Moses and all of the prophets, Jesus interpreted to them in all of the scriptures the things concerning himself. What does that mean? That means that the Bible is a proclamation of who Jesus is coming from God himself. God himself is a witness and a testimony to who his Son is. So we as Christians bear witness to the Son. God the Father bears witness to the Son through his creation and through his word. Who else? Well, Jesus the Son is also a witness for himself. John 8, 18, I am the one who bears witness about myself. And if we keep reading through the book of John, here's what we're going to hear Jesus say. I am the Messiah. I am the bread of life. I am the living water. I am the light of the world. I am the door of the sheep. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the good shepherd. I am the way, the truth, and the light. I am the true vine. In other words, I am just what I have been telling you from the beginning. Now, there's one more who bears witness to Jesus that is absolutely credible, cannot be discredited, cannot be eliminated, and that is the Holy Spirit of God. God the Holy Spirit bears witness regarding the Lord Jesus Christ. This is Romans 8, 16, which says the Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And so while our testimony may be fallible, since we are fallible, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit all testify about Jesus Christ, and their testimony is faithful and true. And so we must testify about Jesus and expect God to do his work in the hearts of people through the work of the Holy Spirit. Amen and amen. Because that's exactly what happened to us when we came to Christ. All right, that's, I don't know, number two. I don't know. Make it whatever number you want. Number three, or next. I think it's important to do a point of clarification here. I have no idea where to put this in the sermon. I just added it here. It's important to understand, because whenever we read the Bible, we can be confused. And verse 15 actually tells us, "You judge according to the flesh, I judge no one." This is Jesus' words. All right. Now, in our minds, when we read that, we're thinking, well, hold on a minute. Jesus does judge. What does this mean? Is this a contradiction in the Bible? Does this discredit him? Now, can we say he's a liar? You must understand not only the context, but also the original language, okay? It's important for us to understand that the word for judge actually means to condemn. What Jesus is saying is, you condemn according to the flesh. I don't condemn at all. What do we know? John chapter 3, verse 17, that one verse after our favorite verse, says, "For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." Jesus is saying to the Pharisees, "You condemn according to the flesh. I came to save according to the Spirit." Man, this is great stuff. I don't know what number I'm on next. When we talked about Jesus saying, "I am the bread of life," we use this term, ego eimi, and it's one of the few times where we see this I am statement. We talked about this a couple of weeks ago, and he does it again here when he says, "I am the light of the world." He says, I am the light of the world. Now, this is also found in the Septuagint in Isaiah 43, verse 11. And I'm just going to end with this statement. It is the word of God. And this is, I think, the crux of everything that's been said up to right now. Isaiah 43:11 says this, I am the Lord. And besides me, there is no Savior. Hallelujah and amen. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful for your word and so thankful for the preservation of it from generation to generation. And God, we thank you that even today you reveal to us who you are and who we are. And God, we do pray that you will continue to spread the testimony of yourself throughout the world, calling your people to yourself. And Lord, may you continue to guide our hearts, to direct our paths, and Lord, to remind us of who Jesus is every moment, every day. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Please stand for the benediction. And now receive the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and give you peace, both now and forevermore. Amen.
Thanks for joining us for worship at Christ Church Presbyterian. We're grateful that you were able to take part in worship with us, and we hope that the time you've spent here has been an encouragement to you. Please remember to stay in touch, and if there's something you need or something you'd like for us to lift up in prayer, call us at 706-210-9090. Of course, please continue to pray for each other and for those who lead us, that they would seek God in their decisions. And don't forget to come back again to our website, myccp.faith, or the Christ Church Facebook page to be a part of worship at Christ Church Presbyterian.